It's a great honor to be here, and especially like since it's the first session and it's the first conference for me. Yes, okay. I don't want to spend too much time like thanking everyone. I'm going to talk about cavity QAD experiments with a strongly interacting Fermi gas. And first, I also would like to thank my supervisor, Professor Jean-Philippe Brantu, for having me at his lab at EPFL, and also my colleagues at the Fermi gas experiment, Victor Helsen, Hideki Konishi, and Kevin Roux, as well as our theory collaborator, Shun Uchino from Japan, that you just like heard about from Giacomo. Yes, there's actually a second experiment also being set up in our group. So if you want to know more about this, I can refer you to the poster session if you're interested. Yes, okay, that's already it. So what's basically the context of our experiments, or in terms of the landscape of quantum matter strongly coupled to light? So I guess, okay, I mean, there have been the pioneering experiments done in the Haroche group on single Rydberg atoms coupled to microwave photons. And there people were looking at like really fundamental properties of light matter coupling that can be understood really well microscopically now. I mean, more recently, one also has solid state platforms like artificial atoms or quantum dots that reach a strong coupling regime. And that can be used for creating more complicated quantum logic or quantum information processing. So, I mean, on the other end of this complexity scale, there are also condensed matter systems whose like material properties can be changed by strong coupling. And here, just to mention one thing, people are interested especially in quantum transport, like superconductivity. And one experiment that I think is really interesting and which was done by Andrea Cavalieri was that if you take some material and you like subject it to some strong terahertz radiation, this material can actually experience transient superconductivity at much higher temperatures than at equilibrium. So having these complex systems on the one side, what one can like wish for is actually to take the systems on the left side and gradually increase the complexity towards the right side and like keep this really good understanding of the system. And okay, first thing that one has to do is to add many atoms in one state and therefore create a Bose-Einstein condensate. And that people have already done several years ago in the cold atoms community, that's nothing new. Then, okay, second step would be to actually add in interactions. And this was already also again like done with BECs by putting them on optical lattices and realizing the superfluid to mod insulator transition together with some cavity mediated interactions. We at EPFL now, we would like to push this even further and take a strongly interacting Fermi gas and look at like what new states of quantum matter can we actually create, and also use cavity QAD methods to probe our system and investigate the properties of it. And that's actually what I'm going to talk about now. So let me first introduce you to our experimental system a little bit better. So we have the two ingredients. So, I mean, we are talking about quantum optics. So it's a strong coupling to photons using our high finesse cavity. And the second thing is the atomic system itself, which is a degenerate Fermi gas with strong collisional interactions that we can simply tune by applying some magnetic field. Okay, so what's actually the properties of our high finesse cavity? So on the right here, you can see our cavity through like one of the viewports of the vacuum chamber. And we actually do like the whole preparation and probing of the system in between those two mirrors. The cavity itself has roughly a spacing of 4 centimeters and a finesse of 47,000, which gives us a line width of 77 kilohertz. And if you take this together with the atomic properties of our system, we get a maximal single photon, single atom coupling of 479 kilohertz. So I guess, I mean, if you're more from like cold atoms and this doesn't tell you like too much, the one thing to actually keep in mind is the cooperativity. And what the cooperativity tells you is that if you take a two-level atom and if you place it in a cavity mode, and now you ask yourself, okay, how likely is it that this two-level atom coherently exchanges an excitation with this cavity field versus like any dissipative process, like spontaneous emission into free space? Then if this cooperativity is larger than one, and for us it's two, you've actually reached the strong coupling regime. So, okay, I mean, if you just want to know more about it, I mean, there's not too much time. There's a nice review article by Vlad and Vuletic. Okay, so now we have the first ingredient. Let's go to the second ingredient, and that's the atomic system itself. So the same as for Giacomo, we have a two-component Fermi gas in the two lowest hyperfine states of lithium-6. And we operate the experiment close to, or like in the vicinity of the Feshbach resonance at 832 Gauss. So that allows us to simply tune the interactions from like strongly attractive and having a molecular BEC to weakly interactive where we have a BCS superfluid. Typically we have like 300,000 atoms per spin state at temperatures of 0.07 TF. So we are deeply in the degenerate regime. And here again, just to mention one thing, we actually also use a new method to prepare our gas. So we use our cavity and we can do it really efficiently in only 3 seconds. And just like this here, we also published a paper on that if you want to like know more about it. Okay, that's the basic system. Now let me convince you that we have actually indeed reached the collective strong coupling regime. So, okay. Here's a measurement of the eigenenergy spectrum of the system, simply done by transmission spectroscopy. So you take your cavity, you shine some light on your cavity on one side, and you record with a single photon counter on the other side what comes out. And you can do this as a function of two parameters, which is the probe cavity detuning and the atom cavity detuning. And if you would simply have like a bare cavity, this would correspond to a straight line here. If you then have like only your atoms, you would only see two absorption features like at these dashed lines. However, since we have this coupled system, we get two anti-crossings for each hyperfine state basically. And that, I mean, you can see it nicely here and there's not much more to say about it. There's some more features in this picture. So, I mean, you have several lines here, and these are simply due to the multimode structure of our cavity. If you want to know more about it, there was a paper published last year in Nature Communications on that. One more thing that I would like to mention here is you see these small features on the left side or on the red side of the atomic transitions. And these actually correspond to the strong coupling of atom pairs to light via some photo association transitions. And we actually, like just 2 weeks ago, we published a paper in Nature on that. That's, however, not the thing I mainly want to talk about today. So I want to talk more about like using cavity QED methods to probe the system and learn something about our strongly interacting Fermi gas. And for this, we actually go away from the atomic transitions far into the dispersive regime, where the light couples to the density of our system. So in this dispersive regime, as I said, we mainly couple to the density. And now we can have a look at the coupling Hamiltonian. So we have here like the intra-cavity photon number coupled to the density weighted by the overlap with the cavity field. So if you only work like take a frozen atomic cloud and you place it inside your optical cavity, this is just a medium with some refractive index, and it will change the optical path length of the cavity itself and simply shift the resonance frequency of your cavity. However, you can also have like a different look at this coupling Hamiltonian, where this coupling Hamiltonian represents an optical lattice to your atoms, and now you let your atoms move. And what happens if you let your atoms move? I mean, they will see some kind of feedback through the optical dipole force. And by probing the system, you actually create some density ripples on top of this density of the atoms. And okay, now you can ask yourself, how can I actually probe this, or what can I do with it? And again, we perform simply transmission spectroscopy. So we sweep our probe laser from the blue side of the cavity to the red side over the resonance. And if you do it fast, the atoms are frozen, and you simply see the dispersively shifted Lorentzian. However, if you let the atoms move and adapt to this photons inside the cavity, this Lorentzian will be distorted. And that's actually what we'll see. So here you simply see the recorded photons with our photon counter as a function of the detuning from the dispersively shifted cavity. And we can now quantify this nonlinearity by creating a simple model with a Kerr medium inside your cavity. So you have some refractive index that depends on the intensity. And we use this model, or we solve this model, fit it, and extract this Kerr parameter eta. Okay, now you can tell me that's nothing new. I mean, people have seen something like this, for example, doing optomechanics with BECs, where this whole thing basically just corresponds to a static displacement of your harmonic oscillator inside your cavity field. However, what's new now is that we can now study this, or connect it to the many-body physics of our system, and study this as a function of the interaction. And that's what we did. So here you can see the different profiles. For like here in blue, it's a molecular BEC to a BCS superfluid here in olive. And if you now track the nonlinearity, so here we have the nonlinearity per atom normalized to the value at unitarity. And if you track it over the whole crossover, you see a clear increase going from the BCS to the BEC side. And that's actually what you would expect intuitively, since on the BEC side, you have some like enhanced density fluctuations, where on the BCS side, they're suppressed due to Pauli blocking. Okay, that's now really nice. Now we can actually make some theory of it, I didn't do it. I mean, our theory collaborator did it, and we can connect it to the short range many body physics of our system using operator product expansion. It's the short range physics because we probe the system at like some, or like the photon wave vector at which we probe is much higher than the Fermi wave vector. And what we see is that this actually can be connected to a few universal properties of our gas. So the first term in this expansion is simply single atoms redistributing. And then the second term is proportional to tons contact, which measures how probable is it to like find atoms at a close distance. And the third term in this expansion, which was new and unexpected, is that it also depends on the internal energy of the gas. Okay, now that we have it, we can compare it to our measurement, and we see it like really nicely, also like here in olive, that's the theory curve, which we get from this operator product expansion. And we plug in some values for the contact that we get from Monte Carlo simulation. And it really nicely fits to our data. Oh, so I mean, it doesn't fit. It's really some ab initio calculation that I show here. Okay, so that's already pretty much the end of my talk. So let me just quickly recap. So I've shown you that we can measure this function. It's something new. So like in contrast to what people have measured like in Bragg spectroscopy, like in Chris Vail's group, they can only measure the contact, but we also get this internal energy contribution. And we can use cavity methods to actually do really precise measurements of density fluctuations in our gas. Just to give you a quick outlook of what we plan to do in the future. So we would like to go closer to these photo association transitions and actually look at the dispersive coupling of pairs to our light field. And then some other research directions is more like in terms of creating new quantum states of matter. And here we are currently in the process of looking at cavity-mediated long-range interactions and self-organization using a transverse pump to our system. And I mean, this is a really like a hot thing for us now, because just 2 weeks ago, there was a paper published by a group in Shanghai doing the same thing for like a non-interacting Fermi gas. That's it from me, I think. Thanks. Any questions?
Yeah, thank you very much, Timo. Who wants to start with questions?
I guess everyone's hungry.
Everybody wants to get coffee. Yeah. Are there any online questions which I don't see currently? Oh, there's. Yeah.
Can you comment a little in the case of this cavity-mediated long range, what is to be expected in terms of new phases or something like that?
I mean, okay, so far we've only basically looked at these corner diagrams, and we can actually enter the self-organized phase, but we don't know what kind of properties, for example, does the self-organized phase have. Is it still superfluid? We didn't see it yet. We have, like, for example, we cannot... Since we have a strongly interacting system, we cannot like look at absorption pictures. This doesn't tell us too much of the system, like they do time of flight for BECs where they see the phase coherence. That we cannot do. So I mean, this is something that we want to have a look at, and also like what are the self, like how does the self-organization go? I think that a bit of different mechanisms compared to BEC, to be honest. But yes, I mean, that's an ongoing thing. We just basically started it. We've seen this, and we're in the process of basically understanding what's going on.
So there's one question by Jean Dalibard from the online audience. we just unmute him. If you can maybe repeat your question, Jean. Maybe.
Yes.
Can you hear us?
Yes. Thanks for the very nice talk. I was wondering whether there would be any interest in redoing this type of experiments with a traveling wave cavity, a ring cavity, instead of a standing wave cavity, especially in having in mind your measurement of the static structure factor. What would be the change if you had a ring cavity?
Now you're talking about self-organization or about the measurement that we. Yes, again, sorry. The ring cavity
for last part of your talk where you measure the static structure factor. So there you had this 2k of the photons which were entering. Now if I go to a ring cavity, the delta k will be much smaller. So would I get some new information with a ring cavity?
That's a difficult question, actually, that answer. To be honest, I'm not sure now. I haven't thought about it, to be honest. For us, since it's a standing wave, it just reduces the number of atoms that actually participate to the thing by a factor of two, since we don't sample the thing homogeneously. I don't know if there's something new to learn if you keep the wave vector at like with the same ratio to kf. But yes, okay, I would have to think about it, to be honest. Yes.
Probably probe at a very different energy scale. Huh? This was your question, Jean.
Yes, this was what I had in mind. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, other questions? Just I have one little question. This ratio between internal energy and contact. Can you say something about this? How big is it, or how big is the contribution?
I didn't show actually the contribution here, but we find that it's actually something on the order of 20% for
us. Okay, so it's a sizable.
Yes, it's a sizable. So I mean, we've first done the theory without the internal energy contribution, and it basically ends up something like this up here. And I mean, you can clearly see that it contributes.
Okay, so then I would say we thank all the speakers for their beautiful contributions this morning. And let's talk about